Welcome to heat.gov. Actually, welcome to the greenhouse. I'm Alex. Climate change is warming the earth so that sometimes, in some places, it's actually too hot to spend a lot of time outside. Both heat and humidity have impacts on human health and our ability to tolerate increasingly warm weather. Today, we're going to calculate relative humidity, dew point, and the heat index from air temperature measurements. We'll also make measurements in different microclimates with the goal of thinking about how to create spaces and communities that are more resilient to climate change. For this experiment, we're going to measure temperature three ways at three different sites. We'll begin by using an infrared thermometer to measure the land surface temperature. Infrared thermometers are often used in cooking or to take your temperature when you're sick. An infrared thermometer measures the temperature of a surface, like your skin. Here, we'll use it to measure the land surface temperature. Next, we'll use a pair of thermometers to measure air temperature and relative humidity. But what is relative humidity? It's the fraction of water vapor present in the atmosphere at a particular temperature relative to the maximum possible amount at that temperature. Relative humidity is a percentage, so the maximum possible is 100%. When the relative humidity is 100%, the air is fully saturated, and it's at its dew point, the temperature at which water vapor condenses to liquid water. To measure relative humidity and dew point, we use a sling psychrometer, an instrument with two standard thermometers mounted together with a handle so that we can swing the thermometers through the air. One of the thermometers wears a little cotton sock. This is called the wet bulb thermometer because we dunk the sock in water so that we can measure the effect of evaporation. The regular thermometer, called the dry bulb, measures the air temperature. These measurements allow us to calculate relative humidity, dew point, and the heat index. Let's take a closer look at the sling psychrometer and particularly what's happening with the wet bulb thermometer. The little sock holds a small reservoir of water around the thermometer bulb. When liquid water is in equilibrium with water vapor in the air, there's movement back and forth between the liquid and the vapor, and those rates of evaporation and condensation are exactly equal. These molecules are always in motion. Their motion and vibration reflect their kinetic energy. If the system is not in equilibrium, then there's a net transfer of liquid to vapor by evaporation, or vapor to liquid by condensation. For example, after dunking the wet bulb in water, it's soaking wet and way out of equilibrium with the surrounding air, so evaporation exceeds condensation. When there's excess evaporation, energy is transferred from the liquid to the vapor. This loss of energy from the liquid lowers its temperature. Evaporation will continue until the system reaches a new equilibrium. We see that with the wet bulb temperature, which is lower than the temperature of the dry bulb.
We're going to use the sling psychrometer to make measurements in two different locations. This one, which is forested, has a lot of vegetation. And so let's get the little sock wet.
Our first field site is in the shade, and here we'll begin with the sling psychrometer. We'll measure the wet bulb and dry bulb temperatures and record those.
Whirl this around for about 30 seconds and see how we do.
Then we'll use the infrared thermometer to measure the ground surface temperature and record that too. When we look at the data, remember that the dry bulb is just the air temperature. Notice that the field site where I'm working, all three of these temperatures are different. We'll go to two other sites, repeat the measurements, and then work through what these temperatures mean.
Which is obviously really open space. Get our sock wet. And because it's a little bit sunny, I'm going to have to try to shade the...
When we compare the first two sites, we immediately notice that all the temperatures in the sun are higher than those in the shade. That's not surprising. And we could stop there and say, okay. But when we measured the wet bulb temperature, we've given ourselves information about water and about energy, and that allows us to gain a lot more insight from these data. But everything we've measured so far is invisible. Let's begin by constructing a physical model that we can see and then relate that to temperature and humidity. Here are four little containers of different size, and we're going to fill them up with colored water. The largest container has the most water and the smallest one has the least, but each one is holding the maximum amount of water for that container. It's 100% full. we can show that with a curve that relates cylinder size and water content. Now, let's fill the containers half full, or 50% of their capacity. We can also draw a curve showing where 50% is. And in fact, we could do this for any water level. Okay, now let's think about water vapor in the air. We'll make a similar graph, this time with temperature on the horizontal axis, moisture content on the vertical axis. The dewpoint curve maps the combinations of temperature and moisture where the air is 100% saturated with water vapor. At the dewpoint, water vapor condenses to liquid. We might see that as clouds, fog, rain, or dew. Notice that as the temperature increases, the maximum possible moisture content of the air also increases. Most of the time, the air around us is going to be in this area, underneath the curve, where water vapor in the atmosphere is less than its maximum. We can also map out the places where the air has less than the maximum moisture content. Like our physical model, let's look at a position halfway to the dew point. For example, where the temperature is 70 degrees Fahrenheit and the relative humidity 50%, that fraction would plot here. That means the dew point would be 50 degrees Fahrenheit. The dew point is also directly related to the actual amount of water in the atmosphere. The higher the dew point temperature, the more moisture. For any temperature, when the relative humidity is 50%, we can mark that position halfway between zero and the dew point. And we can draw a line that represents 50% relative humidity at any temperature. And we can do the same for any relative humidity and make a series of curves for different values of relative humidity. Now we have a graph with three properties that are all related: air temperature, the dew point or moisture content, and relative humidity. To tie these properties to what we're experiencing right now in the real world, we need one more thing: the wet bulb temperature. The lines representing wet bulb temperatures cross across the other three sets of lines. So now we have a graph that has four things on it: dry bulb and wet bulb, which are the things that we measure, and dew point and relative humidity, the things we want to know. And while it might look kind of messy, we're now able to measure two temperatures at our field sites and learn about environmental conditions that can have a big impact on the health of our communities. So let's take our field measurements and see what they tell us. At the shady site, we had a dry bulb of 81 Fahrenheit, wet bulb 75, so our relative humidity is 76% and our dew point is 73 Fahrenheit. In the parking lot, the dry bulb is 86, the wet bulb is 77, so the relative humidity is 67% and the dew point 73. A third measurement was made at a sunny site on the grassy lawn in front of the school, where the dry bulb was 84, the wet bulb was 76, so the relative humidity is 69% and the dew point 73. Because there's so much going on this graph, some people prefer to use a table of values for wet bulb and dry bulb. Here's an example of how that would work for our three sets of measurements. On the table, the dry bulb values are the rows and the wet bulb values are the columns. At our first site in the shade, dry bulb is 81, wet bulb 75, so relative humidity is 76% and dew point 73. In the parking lot, dry bulb is 86, wet bulb 77, so our relative humidity is 67% and dew point 73. And on the grass, the dry bulb is 84, wet bulb 76, relative humidity 69, and dew point 73. Some sling psychrometers even have a little humidity slide rule printed on the thermometer case, and you could use that if you've got one. With the air temperature and the relative humidity, we can also look up the heat index. The heat index combines temperature and humidity to create a measure of human health stress in hot conditions. When we sweat, the evaporating water cools our skin, just like it cools the wet bulb on the sling psychrometer. When the relative humidity is high, there's less evaporation and less cooling. You can see that here, even though the relative humidity was lower in the parking lot, the higher temperature and thus higher heat index there puts us in a zone of extreme caution for outdoor activities. So the quantities that we measure and the other properties that we calculate are all different at these field sites. At this point, we should ask ourselves, why? Let's begin with the surface temperature and make a temperature map of the three types of surfaces using our measurements. The ground under the trees was quite cool, while the parking lot was really hot, and the temperature of the open grassy area was in between the other two. This is because surfaces in the direct sun absorb that incoming solar energy and heat up, like the grassy areas here. Under the trees, even in the shade, some solar energy is still making it through and warming the surface, but it's not nearly as much as at the parking lot. The warm ground also warms the air above it. The super hot parking lot absorbs the most energy and radiates the most energy, and it's a big reason why the air temperature is hottest in the parking lot as well. The same thing happens across entire cities, like here in Washington, D.C. These maps are air temperatures in the early morning, afternoon, and evening. We should also think about what else might be going on in the environment outside our school building. What are the human impacts? What control does the natural environment exert on temperature throughout the day and throughout the year? So the measurements that we've made should get us to start asking questions about the microenvironments in our community. What's the impact of having a lot of pavement? What's the impact of vegetation? And what should we be thinking about if we want to build communities that are going to be healthy places to live and work?